Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the director and the staff at Riverside National Cemetery, I'd like to welcome everyone and also like to express our sincerest condolences for the loss of your loved one. Further, I'd like to express the great honor and pride that you feel that you've chosen our site as the final resting place for your loved one. Before we proceed with the military honors, I'd like to give you a brief description of what's going to transpire. First, we're going to unfold, then refold the flag. Then you're going to hear rifle fire. The rifles sometimes tend to be a little loud, so if you have sensitive hearing or hearing devices, we advise you to protect your ears. That'll be followed by the playing of taps. At the sound of taps, you'll ask that if you're in uniform or have had any military service, that you join us as we render a final and proper salute to our fallen comrades. At that time, if you've had no military service, simply place your right hand above your heart as a show of respect to the veteran. And finally, we'll have the presentation of the flag to you. With your permission, may we continue.
Yes.
At this time, if you can, please rise. Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention towards the front and the flag.
Present a plaque, read a citation from the Debanians, which I was a member of our flight. Family of Colonel Robert R. Arnault, U.S. Air Force, retired, is presented the 30th Flight Order of the Debanians High Flight Plaque in fond memory of our departed brother who placed nation above self on this 12th day of March, 2015. Olabamas. Means we flew. The Order of Dedalians is a national fraternity of commissioned military pilots from all services. It is named after the legendary Greek mythological figure, Dedalus, and was organized by World War I commissioned pilots who sought to perpetuate the spirit of patriotism, love of country, and those high ideals of self-sacrifice which place service to the nation above personal safety and position. Volamos, which means we flew, or I'm sorry, we fly. The poem High Flight was written by a World War II Royal Canadian Air Force pilot, John Gillespie McGee Jr. It has been adopted by many military aviators as poetic symbology, so very descriptive of the devoutly exhilarating experience we enjoy through aerial flight in the defense of our country. I'd now like to read that poem to you. Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter's silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit silence, hovering there, I've chased the shouting wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up, up, along delirious burning blue, I've topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or even eagle flew, and while with silent lifting mind I've trod the high untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touch the face of God. Ladies and gentlemen, the plaque.
Sometime in 1982, our family, newcomers to Riverside, came to the Canyon Crest Country Club to enjoy tennis, swimming, and social activities membership. It was not long before our daughter, Melissa, then 10 years old, met Michelle Arnault at the swimming pool. And it was not long before Bob Arnault appeared on the scene to see who this Mr. Red was swimming with the girls. It was all uphill from there. Soon, Mary Arnault and Jeannie Red were fast friends. And that's how it all started in 82. Over the years, our families have traveled together, vacationed together, partied and socialized together, and even played hearts together when the game was popular. At that time, Bob was discovered on the side practicing moves and developing a siren he called Tube of Gloom to sound off at appropriate times during the game. Since then, we've enjoyed meeting and socializing with some of their many friends. Bob Arnault spoke little of himself and less of his exploits. He was much more interested in family, in his sons, Rob and John, and in his daughter, Michelle. We are mindful of his many and frequent trips to San Clemente with Mary to be with grandson Jake and granddaughter Olivia. We remember, too, so many gatherings of family and friends at the Arnault home. Can we forget all of the many emails forwarding humorous pictures, stories, and jokes, whether timely or just somehow appropriate? The many times we enjoyed meals at Art's downtown Riverside, a haunt known to Bob from his Riverside County days. Bob aimed to please. For one cruise, Jeannie asked Bob to bring along his dress mess uniform. He gladly complied, and we now have a remarkable photograph taken aboard ship of Bob in formal dress mess with Mary in formal dress. We were scheduled to take a cruise together on the 1st of March this year, but plans change. We learned of his heroism in the Vietnam theater of the war, not from him, but from those around Bob who knew. This we know, Bob was a gallant patriot and helicopter pilot who put his life on the line daily for his fellow airmen and for his country. I know Bob well enough to know two things. First, he would say, "Keep this brief, Red." And secondly, "Stick to the subject. Don't make this about yourself, Red." With those parting words, I would like to close with a parting prayer. May the angels and saints guide you into paradise, Bob, for all eternity. Please pray for us here that we may one day join you there forever. May God bless us all.
Amen.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you for everybody that's made it out here today. Family and friends. My dad would have been very humble and thinking why you're making such a big fuss over him. I'd like to say a few words to help celebrate the memory of my father by sharing a few parts of his life that he was very proud of. Chuck Red said there, he didn't often talk about many of the things in his life that he was so proud about. but I'd like to touch on a few of those. And as you all knew my father, he definitely had a sense of humor. So I promise I'll throw one little quick story and he would be happy about it. Colonel Arnault was an amazing man who lived an amazing life. He was a highly decorated combat pilot. He was an accomplished engineer. He was a loving husband. He was a terrific father, and he was a doting grandfather. Bob was born in South Florida in 1933 in the Depression. His family had very little money, but they were always very close, and they always loved each other very much. His motto, family, came first. My dad, I'll give you my quick story because I need to do it now. My dad's first day of high school, the Arnault family had been in this country for over 200 years and nobody had ever gone to college. My dad went to his first day of high school and the teacher looked at him and said, Arnault, any relations with other Arnaults that have been through here? I said, yes, sir. He said, if you're anything like them, you might as well leave right now. True story. Nice to tell you. My dad had different plans. He earned a full ride college scholarship and to the University of Miami. He commuted down there, living at home, couldn't afford the textbooks, so he worked full-time delivering mail while he went to college. There was no quit in that man. He was the first person to attend and graduate from college in the Arnault family. My dad entered the Air Force to be an engineer. The Air Force had other plans for him. He said, you have good eyes, you're a pilot. So they sent him to pilot training, and he used the bit of advice that he gave to me, to my brother and sister, and that I give to my children. Whatever you're going to do, do it the best of your ability. And the engineer went to pilot training and graduated first in his class. He used that bit of logic and wisdom over the next 29 years as a sometimes engineer, mostly pilot, and commander in the Air Force. My dad went to Vietnam when he was 35 years old, and he didn't need to go. But his friends had all gone, and he felt indebted that it was his turn. He had a wife and two children, so he had a lot to lose. He became a highly decorated combat helicopter pilot. We found letters in his safe after he passed that he wrote on the flight back from Vietnam. And in the letters, he talked about what a hero was and what heroism is. And it's not the person that goes to look to become a hero. It's the person that's there that is terrified, that has a lot to lose. And they know they have a lot to lose. Yet they look to the men next to them and they say, it's my job to take care of them. My dad overcame his fear, took care of his men, did the mission. He was a hero. After 29 years in the Air Force, my father finally got to do what he wanted to do. He became an engineer and he got to build. He went to work for Riverside County, the director of the general agency, and he built. He built courthouses, he built jails, he built sheriff stations, he built libraries. He helped turn a downtrodden downtown Riverside into the vibrant area that it is. He was very proud of his adopted hometown. My father was most proud of his very close family. He spent 52 years married to my amazing mother. He was very much in love with her. The very last. She supported him in his career. There are 18 moves in the Air Force. She raised the three children. She was the rock of the family. My dad married the prettiest girl in the room, who turned out to be the strongest and toughest and best wife. My dad was very proud of his children, and what he was most proud about was the people they turned out to be, loving, close. He was proud that they followed in his footsteps and went to college, but he was more proud that they became very good people who put other people first. Pop-Up was a very proud Papa was very proud of his two grandchildren. He doted on them. And he lit up when he was around them. My father did not brag. He bragged about his grandchildren, Jake and Luke. I can still see them to this day, out back, teaching the kids to swim, teaching them how to shoot the BB gun. Okay, and I can hear the laugh of Jake, Liv, and my dad watching the Three Stooges. They were truly his pride and joy. My father, as a human being, was a very kind man, equally quick to laugh or cry. He was a patriotic American, and he bled red, white, and blue. He was a close friend to so many, as you can see from everybody here. He was generous and would give the shirt off his back. He was a true family man who loved with all of his heart. He was a role model for so many of us. He showed us the right way to act. He will be incredibly missed. Colonel, the Lord has called his aviator home. It's time to return to base. Your mission is complete and heaven awaits you. Goodbye, Dad. We love you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've gone about as far as we can go today with the Colonel. Shortly, I will have a transport arriving to take him to his final resting place. I've presented Mrs. Arnold with a map to that location. Now, that site will be ready for visitors after 4 o'clock today, or any time in the future thereafter. For those of you who wish to visit the burial site in the future and don't have ready access to the map, whenever you enter the cemetery through the main gate, you see a large building on the right. That's the admin building. Outside of that building, as well as in the lobby, you'll find machines. They look very much like ATM machines. They're called grave locators. If you enter the last name and then the first, to print you the identical map that was presented to the family. Now we're open 7 days a week, 365 days a year, from sunup to sundown. So you're all more than welcome to visit whenever you wish. Regrettably, I have to ask that once the Colonel has been removed from this area, that everyone returns to their cars, simply because you'll have to utilize this space to honor another veteran and yet another fan. Thank you again, and have a safe remainder of the day.
Thank you.
Once again, man.
Thank you.